Hello and welcome to BharatShakti.in. I'm Nitin Gokhale and I'm privileged to have with me the Chief of the Indian Army, General M.M. Naravane, talking to us on the Army's contribution in combating COVID-19 pandemic across India and of course his future plans for the Army's restructuring and modernization. General Naravane, welcome to this program.
Thank you very much, Nitin.
About to complete about 4 months into being in this chair, you took over on 31st of December 2019. How has been the experience so far? What have been the main challenges?
Well, the experience so far has, of course, been very nice. When I had taken over, I had, during the Army Day press conference, outlined some of my guiding philosophy, which was allegiance, belief, continuity, integration, training, personnel, and quality. And I'm trying to build up on those. When I took over, I had 2 years and 4 months as my tenure as the chief. So these 4 months, as you have pointed out, I have used it to go around to various formations, see the situation on the ground, and based on that, to try and formulate what should be the roadmap for the 2 years to come. And these have been very interesting 4 months because I have visited places where I had not been since my days as a second lieutenant.
Oh, that's long ago.
long time. Yeah. So this refresher was required so that I can take a holistic view of the entire army, see the inputs from the ground, so that we don't go wrong as we go ahead.
That's right.
And as...
Yeah, go ahead.
As any chief would want, he would always like to further improve upon whatever he has inherited and further enhance the operational standards, the operational readiness, and make his force more fighting fit. So we are working towards that. We have identified how we can further enhance our standards, and that will be as a result of a combination of different force structuring, force structures. Once we decide upon that, how to man this new force in terms of equipment, arms, the manning, staffing levels. And once these two things are in place, then what would be the way that we strategize or change our strategy in keeping with the changing times and our amendments to our tactics, techniques, procedures. So keeping all this in mind, I am in the process of formulating certain goals, short-term, medium-term, long-term. And I hope that I should be able to achieve at least a majority of those, and these goals will address all these issues and will without leaving anyone behind. It will address all arms and services. It will address equipping modernization issues. It will address HR concerns and so on and so forth.
Yeah, that's great to know because you've actually encapsulated your vision and your planning for the force itself. But in the middle of all this, we have been hit, the world has been hit by the COVID-19 pandemic. It's unprecedented in its fury and spread. I know that the Indian Army is at the forefront of this battle. Give us some idea about what the Indian Army is doing and how it is helping the national effort.
Yes, the COVID crisis has certainly been a very disruptive influence. We always have been talking about black swan events and theorizing about that, but we never really expected it to actually happen.
That's right.
So this has come as a disruptive influence. And at a larger, seeing it at a larger level, it is going to make a difference in how we operate in the future, in our way of life. I'm talking, beyond the army also.
True.
Is going something which we will have to factor in, not only COVID, but similar kind of things. Whenever we do anything in the future, we will have to do it under this kind of a overhang so that we don't get taken by surprise ever again. As far as the COVID battle is concerned, we had been monitoring the global situation and the internal situation. And based on that and the inputs that we were getting, we had taken some remedial measures as early as middle of February, when I had in fact made a point that force preservation is my main task. That I have to keep my force absolutely fighting fit, unless my army is fit and free from infection, I will not be able to do the full justice to the entire gamut of roles that I have to perform, both guarding the borders, looking after the counter-insurgency, counter-terrorism grid, both in the north and northeast, as well as to come to the aid of the civil administration as required.
Right.
Fortunately, we have not had too many cases. We have had 14 cases so far only, and out of that, two have already recovered and are back on active duty. So that part is well under control.
Right.
As far as the assistance is concerned to the civil admin, we were in fact one of the first to set up a quarantine camp, which came about at Manesar, and that is where the first lot of people came who were evacuated from Wuhan. After that, we made two more camps at Jaisalmer and Jodhpur, both catering for about 700 and 500 each, where evacuees have come from various parts of the world. And after having done their mandatory quarantine and testing and so on and so forth, we even sent them back to their home states. And that strength in those camps has now come down from 400-500 to about 100-150. That's so we are helping in that regard.
Yeah, but the COVID has also altered, I'm sure, many of the old notions, old training methods, doctrines. What is that something new that you have done, or some innovative methods that you adopted for adjusting your training, you know, transporting your personnel? Give us some different idea on that.
Actually, if you see this effect of the COVID, there are certain positives and negatives by virtue of being in the army. If you look at the positives, positives are that we are in our military camps and our cantonments, which are, as it is, isolated from the general populace. So that has been an advantage and of a benefit to us in trying to keep ourselves secure. So that has definitely helped. And I'll come to that a little later.
Right.
Also. But the negatives is that we have to operate in close proximity with each other, especially in the border areas, when we are doing our operations in the hinterland. If you're in an ambush, you have to be close together. You can't say that we're 5 meters apart.
You can't
be together.
Certainly.
Certain things we can modify, adapt. Certain things we have to be together.
True.
In being together, it has been of a benefit to us that we have been segregated from the population, especially in the border areas, in GNC. Yes. In high altitude, where right. people come into contact with anybody else, they can continue operating as per the teachings. So, therefore, it has been a positive.
That's true.
That sense. But yes.
In terms of training, or you know, your people who must have been on leave, you had to run some military specials. In that sense, Army, of course, has a great ability to do logistics under adverse circumstances. But in this case, did you have to really go out of your way to, you know, get the planning done, work with the civil administration, the railways? How have you managed to do that? About 2 lakh odd people have gone and come back, is what I heard or read somewhere. Is that correct?
So when this lockdown was announced and we came to know that so many of our personnel will have to remain wherever they are, whether who is on course will have to remain where he's doing that training, whether it is Mau or Bangalore or Ahmednagar or wherever he is, plus another category who are on leave.
Right.
Now, as far as the people who are in training institutions are concerned, they were, as I said, as it is isolated. So we could say in a sense that they are already green. So for them to be moved out was not really a problem. The problem was how to move them out.
Yeah.
For which then we went in for these military specials, which were of course themselves sanitized. So that was a green component, moving with a mode of transport which is green, and getting down at the other end, which is also a green area, are designated units or transit camps. So the entire route is sort of green channel where you can move around.
That's very innovative. Yeah.
Now when you come to personnel on leave,
yeah. Now,
when they start coming back, we will first have to quarantine them for 14 days.
Right.
It is only after that that they will be declared green, and then the same system can start up. So while in the first phase, we are moving out the people on courses who were already safe, simultaneously, we have asked people to start rejoining at the nearest army unit so that again they can be go through this period of 14 days quarantine and testing if required. And right. By the time phase one movement is over, then the phase two we will be able to start. So such like things we have put into motion.
Right.
But after force preservation, the next task comes is force regeneration. So people who are doing this task cannot do it endlessly. They have to be relieved. And then that lot also has to be sent on leave.
I agree. Yeah.
This is a continuous cycle.
Continuous process.
And as I said, we will have to now make our processes, assuming that this COVID threat is not going to go away anytime soon.
True.
Throughout the year, probably we will have to do something like that.
So, apart from the immediate things that you have done, I also want to sort of look at the larger issue. I remember talking about and speaking about asymmetric threats, non-traditional security threats. Now it's clearly proved that a pandemic like this is a possibility. It's a real possibility across the globe. In that sense, the army is the best prepared force anywhere, in any country, most of the countries rather. So your doctors have done tremendously well in terms of, protocols, in terms of giving, help to civil administration and all that. In the future, when you look at force structuring, force preservation that you've spoken about, also your doctrines, will you factor in all this? You'll have to factor in all this. How will you do it? And that's the question, because you've just postponed your Army Commanders Conference. I'm sure you're still talking about it, how to go about it. Can you give us some idea on that?
So as a result of this, we've of course had to have a rethink on how we will be fighting in the future. And we have, in fact, doing some brainstorming on this as we speak. We are taking inputs from our regional commands and trying to draw out a roadmap. But that said, we have always had capability to fight in a NBC environment, nuclear, biological, chemical warfare environment.
True.
So it is not that we do not have any capacities or capabilities at all. But probably we will have to build further on them. May not be to that high intensity as a classical NBC environment is concerned.
Right.
But lower intensity to cater for such kind of pandemics, which may not be that serious as far as mortality is concerned.
Exactly. So CBRN, which used to be like, one of the peripheral issues, will take center stage in the future, planning and future doctrines and tactics that will come. That's what I'm guessing, as you mentioned just now. But let me come to more mundane issues, like, you have had this plan, your predecessor had made this plan about IBGs, integrated battle groups, and restructuring of the army, making it leaner and meaner, the Shekhar committee report. How will that now get factored into all this? How will that get affected?
No, those restructurings won't get affected in that sense. As I mentioned right at the beginning, that when you go in for a more efficient or try to enhance the effectiveness of the force, those 3-4 factors come into play. And one of them is force restructuring. Mm-hmm. So that is very much still a work in progress. We have identified the formations which will undergo this change in the first phase. So they have been test bedded. It is only that things have now got delayed because of not being able to move out and actually put that into motion. But that is something which is going to happen. The IBC concept will happen. The restructuring of the army headquarters will happen. That is the way for the future. There is no doubt in my mind that future wars will be going in that direction.
Right. So, in that respect, one more concern that is being expressed across the specialist field of defense and defense analysis is also about the pressure under which the defense budget will come, given the precarious economic condition that is going to be staring the country in the face, not just our country, but all the countries across the globe, probably. In that sense, will lower defense budgets or squeeze defense budgets affect your modernization plans, your replenishment plans? How are you looking at that challenge going forward?
Well, firstly, as far as the budget is concerned, I would like to make one point that it is a government's responsibility to provide for its citizens a safe and secure environment.
Right.
And only when you have a safe and secure environment can the country flourish. So, expenditure on defense should be seen as an investment. We also contribute through the armed forces. And if you see past incidents which have taken place, whether it is 26/11, Doklam, or the parliament attacks, whenever such incidents have happened, invariably the stock market has gone down. So, it shakes investor confidence.
True.
You need a strong armed forces, no matter what. And it is because the country is strong and it is able to face these challenges that the economy remains robust. So, we have to continue investing in national security. I'm not just saying army or armed forces.
Exactly.
If the nation is secure, the nation prospers. So, therefore, an investment in that has to continue no matter what the circumstances. That cannot be allowed to decline.
Right.
Plus, we have two neighbors which are inimical to us. That is not going to change. So, once again, we have to face the facts that you have to, no matter what, even though there will be cuts, they cannot be so deep as to compromise our entire the national security framework. After all, we are not only looking at our own security, but we are a security provider for the whole of South Asia.
Exactly.
We are one of the countries which is a pillar of stability.
Exactly.
We cannot be seen to be faltering.
I think very well put there, Janu Narayane. Talking about neighbors, you recently went to Jammu and Kashmir, and I think you also mentioned there that the Western neighbor Pakistan is continuing with its attempts to send in infiltrators, continuing the proxy war. What is your sense? I mean, after having come back from there and even otherwise, why are they doing this? I mean, are they not in a precarious or more precarious condition than India is economically and otherwise?
Well, yes, it is. And in fact, this is a strategy which they've been pursuing for more than two decades now. And a strategy which has not borne fruit. And why they're persisting with a strategy which is failing really beats the imagination. The first thing that we are taught in the army is that don't reinforce failure. But they just seem to be doing that.
True.
And theirs is a strategy of death by a thousand cuts. Our strategy will be death by a thousand and one cuts. That us one will always be with us.
Correct.
They will never succeed.
Right.
The sooner they realize that it is a failed strategy, the sooner they realize that it will augur well for both countries to have peaceful borders, both of us can grow. So, I can only leave it at that, that good sense has to prevail.
Yeah.
So that, otherwise it really beats me why they should continue with a strategy which is not paying any dividends to anybody.
Yeah, that's right. So, let me move away from the Jammu and Kashmir situation or northeast or wherever. there is one thing that I spoke about the budget, and you actually answered it very well, that it's an investment in national security, any budget that is given or money that is spent. One of the complaints that have been there even before you took over from the Indian defense industry has been that while there is big talk by the government, by the armed forces, especially by the army also, that Make in India will be our mantra, we will give as many orders as possible to Indian defense companies. The sense that I'm getting, I'm doing a series on BharatShakti.in on speaking to industry leaders, and they all seem to complain that they don't get enough orders or they don't get enough quick orders in order to sustain themselves. How will you overcome that challenge or that complaint from the Indian industry?
To answer the first part of the question, actually, about the budgetary constraints.
Right.
There is no doubt that there will be some cuts. We are not denying that.
Sure.
But we will be able to absorb that by cutting down on a few other essential things which we would normally be doing, like our exercises with troops, which involve move of large units and formations, which is an expensive proposition. The 1 month plus lockdown, which has happened, since movements have not occurred during this month, it has automatically resulted in some savings.
True.
So because of this, we will be able to manage the budget. I don't think our modernization programs would suffer to a large extent. Moreover, whatever modernization plans we had, at least in the coming year, were mostly Make in India or orders going to Indian companies. So, and that is another way in which the expenditure that we do will kickstart our economy, because the orders are going to Indian companies and they in turn are giving sub orders to the smaller MSMEs.
Exactly.
So actually, the downstream flow of this expenditure will actually help all our citizens and all these smaller enterprises. And as far as the number of orders is concerned, actually, as far as the army's orders are there, our order book, almost 75%, both by cost and by volume, the number of orders have gone to Indian companies, which includes, of course, the ordnance factories and the PSUs.
Of course, they are Indian. So
it may not be so much to the private industries as such.
True.
So that way, they have perhaps a point that they are not getting adequate orders. We are working to that. We are working towards trying to make the procedures more favorable, that the private industries and companies can also participate. And this is a fledgling. We are still experimenting with this. So obviously, there are going to be teething troubles. But as we go by, I'm confident that more and more orders will start going to them. And PSUs and the OFBs will have to compete on a level playing field.
Yeah, I think that's the way forward, and you put it very well that the moment the defense expenditure is put out in the market, or you start expending money, you start spending money, that will have a cascading effect on the entire industry and thereby on parts of the economy, which I think should be the case. And it reminds me of, reminds me of what happened in the American scenario in 1941-42, when they were drawn into the Second World War, and then they had to really ramp up their production. That really boomed into a great economy after that. So war economies sometimes always becomes a major factor in the country's booming economy. But we'll see whether that will happen or not. But General Narawane, thank you very much for your time and being so frank about whatever the army is doing and is planning in the future. Hopefully, we will all come out of this COVID-19 crisis unscathed and with our health intact. But we hope to see you sometime again on this program. But for the moment, thank you very much.
Thank you, and always a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you.